What did the Earth look like during the age of dinosaurs? Welcome to the Natural History of Dinosaurs. My name is Benjamin Berger. I'm a paleontologist teaching at Utah State University in the heart of Utah's dinosaur country in Vernal. In this video, we'll look at the world of dinosaurs, the Mesozoic Era, 252 million years ago to 66 million years ago. Today, we'll see how the continents were arranged and where the great ancient seas and oceans lay on the Earth. We'll try to picture the topography of the Earth. Where were the mountains? Where were the great basins? How did the rivers flow? And where in this ancient world did the dinosaurs live? This is the world of the late Triassic. 220 million years ago, as envisioned by the geologist Ron Blakey. These maps are compiled from hundreds of geological interpretations as to the differing depositional environments of similar aged rocks and the position of the continents based on paleomagnetic measurements in the rocks. Here we see in the Triassic that the continents are all together, lined up on a single side of the Earth, with this enormous shoreline that extends all the way down from near the North Pole down to the South Pole. If you were an early dinosaur living during this period of time, you could walk across every continent that today is divided by great oceans. This is the supercontinent, Pangaea. And near the equator, we see a giant mountain range with peaks that would rival the Himalayas today. This is the Appalachian Mountains at their zenith. These massive mountains divide Pangaea into a north and south. In the north, vast deserts and wide, broad basins expanded out from the massive mountain range. In Arizona, New Mexico, and Utah, the late Triassic was forested, but these forests were pounded by intense El Niño and La Niña cycles, a super monsoon system along a long coastline, which made some years extremely wet and others extremely dry. It was a land of extremes, and the dinosaurs that first arose during the Triassic were able to live in these extreme environments. In the far north, we have present-day Europe and Asia. Here, it was less extreme, and larger dinosaurs can be found wandering these more equable northern lands. In the south, in a land called Gondwanaland, we have a broad forested land, which today is rich in Triassic fossils. In the portion that would later form South America, the earliest and most complete dinosaurs are known. In South Africa, a rich Triassic fauna is known and may hold the key to understanding the origin of dinosaurs. And then you have Australia. And yes, parts of this massive land area in the south was Antarctica. And Triassic fossils from Antarctica show that it was a warm. Now let's jump forward to 150 million years ago, to the time of the late Jurassic. This is the peak time for dinosaurs, when dinosaurs truly ruled the Earth. Now something very significant has happened. The North American continent has pulled away from Pangaea, splitting right down along the Appalachian Mountains. The mountains remain along the eastern coastline, but are now smaller and more eroded. As the North American continent moves west and north, it bulldozes through the Pacific Ocean, and as it does so, a new mountain range appears called the Severe Orogeny. An orogeny is a mountain building event. We also see that Europe and Asia have split off, forming a broad series of islands called an archipelago. In the south, we see that Africa and South America still embracing each other, and Australia and Antarctica are locked just north of the South Pole. The Jurassic period was the first time that the continents were becoming isolated from each other, where oceans separated these large land masses. The dinosaurs became unique in each continent during this time, and as we'll see, the Gondwanaland dinosaurs evolved in isolation from the northern dinosaurs, and unique and strange forms arose on these newly isolated continents. Now we jump forward to 90 million years ago, to the Cretaceous period. Here we see all the continents are now isolated, even India, a landmass that we don't think of as a continent. It's isolated in the middle of the Indian Ocean. And look at North America. As it moved west, the severe orogeny formed a large mountain range, but it rippled like folds in a rug pushed along the floor. A low basin has flooded with the sea, splitting North America into two continents, Latimedia to the west and Appalachia to the east. Europe was a series of islands in a sea away that flowed across what is now the Middle East. This sea was the Tethys Seaway, a warm, biologically rich ocean near the equator that allowed the passage of water to circulate trans-equatorially, making the world globally warm. These warm waters would produce the rich petroleum that fuels today's wars in the Middle East. And even though Antarctica was at the South Pole and Alaska was near the North Pole, the fossils found there show that they were warm and tropical regions, and snow rarely fell even in these high polar regions. This world was divided, and each region supported a unique dinosaur fauna. And now, we have the world 66 million years ago, at the very end of the Mesozoic, the age of dinosaurs. It looks somewhat like our modern world. India is still making its way across the ocean to collide with Asia. Africa and Eurasia are still separated by the Tethys Seaway that would later form the Mediterranean Sea. And Rob Blakey has illustrated that North America is isolated from South America. But there is some paleontological evidence that these two continents, around this time, contacted each other, exchanging small mammals, but would quickly separate again, and only with the formation of the Isthmus of Panama a few million years ago, result in another great American interchange. This was the last great period of the dinosaurs. Now you should be able to assemble the positions of the continents during the Mesozoic and predict locations of the active origins, these mountain building events, and the locations of the oceans and seaways.